Hello, my little yokai. How are you guys doing today? Or tonight? So, hey, Crimson Wyvern, what's up? How's it going? Thanks for joining. Yuka, thanks for joining. Artorius, what's up? Streety McMeedy, how's it going? Random Human, this is the earliest you've ever been? Oh, this is the latest I've ever been. What's up, Nikki? How's it going? Wither Jolly, hey. Cassie, oh no, is it lagging? Please don't tell me it's lagging. Please. Just a random person on the internet. What's up, random person? All right, so I was reading some ghost stories, and I figured, hey, why don't I read for you assholes? It'll be more fun, right? So that's what I'm doing. This is like a surprise live stream for Halloween. So I got my house ready. I turned off all the lights. So the house is nice and quiet and scary. So I'm getting myself in the mood. Hope you guys are in the mood too. It's not lagging? Good job. Good job, internet. So I have my candle. So the only light in my room is my candle and the computer. And I got some tea ready. Yeah. Well, happy Halloween, you guys. You like my room? You like my lighting? I think it's looking pretty cool. What's up, Johanna? How's it going? Yeah, and if you look in the back, this is kind of scary too. Like imagine if someone just, like some creature just peeked through the blinds as I'm reading. That would be funny. All right. So I'll be reading some ghost stories from this book called Japanese Ghost Stories by Lafcadio Hearn. So he's very famous. And these are like old traditional ghost stories. All right, so we have a choice. We have a choice. So I can either read with this, where you just see my face as I'm reading, or I can change it to this, and you can follow me along while I'm reading. So let me know in the chat what you want to do, how you want to do it. It's easier to follow if I have it open like this. But I'm thinking, I don't know, the camera adds a little atmosphere to the reading. Moke-chan, what's up? Some nice bedtime stories for you. The chat is like 15 seconds delayed. All right, we got face close up, face follow along, face read along, face. I can't do both. How do I do both? Face show screen, face. How do I do both? Let me see. All right, I'm going to mess with my setup here. That's not how you do it. Green. All right, let's do it. Let's switch off for each story, okay? Because it's kind of half and half. I think face is winning, but it's kind of half and half. All right, let's switch. Let's do the first story with my face, my beautiful face, or scary. Either works. Okay, you ready? Are you ready for the first story? Some are short, some are long. So I have a couple of stories. I just scanned through these, okay? I didn't read through all of them. So I just scanned through them before the stream. So I don't really know what's going on. But there may be words that we'll have to look up because they have Japanese words. All right. Let's do this. Let's get started. Woo! All right, this is a story. This is a chapter called Of Ghosts and Goblins. Oh, Ivan says your face is better than my costume. I don't know if that's is that an insult or is that a compliment? Let's go. Will I do voices? I'll try to do voices. I'm not a professional voice actor, but I'll try. Okay, I have a decent girl's voice. A decent, like, soft girl's voice. I can do that for you guys. Okay, let's do this. Let's do this. Of Ghosts and Goblins. I think that's the chapter name, but it's not the story name. The story doesn't have a name. A long time ago, in the days when fox women and goblins haunted this land, there came to the capital with her parents a samurai girl, so beautiful that all men who saw her fell enamored of her, and hundreds of young samurai desired and hoped to marry her and made their desire known to her parents. For it has ever been the custom in Japan that marriages should be arranged by parents, but there are exceptions to all customs. And the case of this maiden was such an exception. Her parents declared that they intended to allow their daughter to choose her own husband, and that all who wished to win her would be free to woo her. Many men of high rank and of great wealth were admitted to the house as suitors, and each one courted her as best knew how, with gifts, with fair words, and with poems written in her honor. And with promises of eternal love. And to each one she spoke sweetly and hopefully, but she made strange conditions. For every suitor she obliged to bind himself by his word of honor as a samurai to submit to a test of his love for her, and never to divulge to a living person what that test might be. And to this all agreed. But even the most confident suitors suddenly ceased their importunities after having been put to the test, and all of them appeared to have been greatly terrified by something. Indeed, not a few even fled away from the city, and could not be persuaded by their friends to return. But no one ever so much as hinted why. Therefore, it was whispered by those who knew nothing of the mystery that the beautiful girl must either be a fox woman, or a goblin. I think it's translated as goblin, but it's probably yokai. Now, when all the wooers of high rank had abandoned their suit, there came a samurai who had no wealth but his sword. He was a good man, and true, and of pleasing presence, and the girl seemed to like him. But she made him take the same pledge which the others had taken, and after she had taken it, she told him to return upon a certain evening. When that evening came, he was received at the house by none but the girl herself. With her own hands, she set before him the repast of hospitality, and waited upon him, after which she told him that she wished him to go out with her at a late hour. To this he consented gladly, and inquired to what place she desired to go. But she replied nothing to his question, and all at once became very silent, strange in her manner. And after a while, she retired from the apartments, leaving him alone. Only long after midnight she returned, robed all in white, like a soul, and without uttering a word, signed him to follow her. Out of the house they hastened, while all the city slept. It was what is called an oborozukiyo. Oborojizukiyo, moon-clouded night. Always upon such a night, tis said, do ghosts wander. Wait. Always upon such a night, tis said, do ghosts wander. She swiftly led the way, and the dogs howled as she flitted by. And she passed beyond the confines of the city to a place of knolls shadowed by enormous trees, where an ancient cemetery was. Into it she glided, a white shadow into blackness. He followed, wandering, his hand upon his sword. Then his eyes became accustomed to the gloom, and he saw. By a new-made grave, she paused and signed to him to wait. The tools of the gravemaker were still lying there. Seizing one, she began to dig furiously, with strange haste and strength. At last, her spade smote a coffin lid and made it boom. Another moment, and the fresh white wood of the kwan was bare. That's the coffin. She tore off the lid, revealing a corpse within, the corpse of a child. With goblin gestures, she wrung an arm from the body, wrenched it in twain, and squatting down, began to devour the upper half of the arm. Then, flinging to her lover the other half, she cried to him, "Eat, if thou lovest me. It is what I eat." Not even for a single instant did he hesitate. He squatted down upon the other side of the grave and ate the other half of the arm and said, "Kekko de gozarimasu. Mo skoshi chōdai." Which means, "It is excellent. Please give me some more." Let me do that again. Which means, "It is excellent. I pray you, give me a little more. For that arm was made of the best kwashi that Saikyo could produce." Kwashi is a type of candy, I believe. That's what it says. Then the girl sprang to her feet with a burst of laughter and cried, "You only of all my brave suitors did not run away, and I wanted a husband who could not fear. I will marry you. I can love you. You are a man." That's it. That's the end. So did you get it? Did you get it? It wasn't a real corpse. It was made of candy. She was just tricking all the other suitors. Oh, well, she was tricking all the suitors just to find someone who had no fear and would eat that arm with her. How was that for our beginning story? Did you guys understand the story, or do I need to use the screen? How's my girl's voice, by the way? Tell me,
do you like my girl's voice? Like, does it sound like a girl to you?
Lash says that she wouldn't date a man like that. Seriously. Yeah, tell me in the chat, would you guys eat that thing? That's true. Like, I wouldn't date a guy like that. That's not cool. Like, how did he didn't know. He didn't know that it was made of candy. Dun, dun, dun. Amazing girl's voice. Hey, chat is giving me a 10 out of 10 for my girl's voice. Rin says it sounds like a girl I'd eat an arm for. Hell yeah. It said she was super, super beautiful. What is up, Hannah? Crimson Wyvern. Oh, okay. Crimson Wyvern says no different from my normal voice. Thanks a lot, Crimson. All right, let's choose the live screen and see if you guys like this better. So I think the next story is pretty short. Now, I haven't... So, yeah, I've only scanned these stories, so I haven't read through all of them. So, some of them may be duds, but let's just go with it. All right, you guys. Let's go with our next stories. These don't have... This one doesn't have a title. Let me do this. Boop, boop, boop. Close that. All right. Can I full screen this? Control F. Oh, that's fine. F. Nope. All right, next story. You ready? Long ago, in the days of a daimyo whose name has been forgotten, there lived in this old city a young man and a maid who loved each other very much. Their names are not remembered, but their story remains. From infancy, they had been betrothed, and as children, they played together, for their parents were neighbors. And as they grew up, they became always fonder of each other. Before the youth had become a man, his parents died, but he was able to enter the service of a rich samurai, an officer of high rank, who had been a friend of his people. And his protector soon took him into great favor, seeing him to be courteous, intelligent, and apt at arms. So the young man hoped to find himself shortly in a position that would make it possible for him to marry his betrothed. But war broke out in the north and east, and he was summoned suddenly to follow his master to the field. Before departing, however, he was able to see the girl, and they exchanged pledges in the presence of her parents. And he promised, should he remain alive, to return within a year from that day to marry his betrothed. After his going, much time passed, without news of him, for there was no post in that time as now. And the girl grieved so much for thinking of the chances of war that she became all white and thin and weak. Then at last she heard of him through a messenger sent from the army to bear news to the daimyo. And once again a letter was brought to her by another messenger. And thereafter there came no word. Long is a year to one who waits. And the year passed and he did not return. Other seasons passed, and still he did not come, and she thought him dead, and she sickened, and lay down, and died, and was buried. Then her old parents, who had no other child, grieved unspeakably, and came to hate their home for the lonesomeness of it. After a time, they resolved to sell all they had, and to set out upon a Sengaji, the great pilgrimage to the 1,000 temples of the Nichiren Shu, which requires many years to perform. So they sold their small house with all that it contained, excepting the ancestral tablets and the holy things which must never be sold, and the ihai of their buried daughter. I think that's a, let's see what that is, a thing that contains your ashes? A mortuary tablet. A tablet of their buried daughter, which were placed according to the custom of those about to leave their native place in the family temple. Now the family was of the Nichiren Shu, and their temple was Myokoji. They had been gone only 4 days when the young man, who had been betrothed to their daughter, returned to the city. He had attempted, with the permission of his master, to fulfill his promise. But the provinces upon his way were full of war, and the roads and passes were guarded by troops, and he had been long delayed by many difficulties. And when he heard of his misfortune, he sickened for grief, and many days remained without knowledge of anything, like one about to die. But when he began to recover his strength, all the pain of memory came back again, and he regretted that he had not died. Then he resolved to kill himself upon the grave of his betrothed, and as soon as he was able to go out unobserved, he took his sword and went to the cemetery where the girl was buried. It is a lonesome place, the cemetery of Myokoji. There he found her tomb, and knelt before it, and prayed, and wept, and whispered to her that which he was about to do. and suddenly he heard her voice cry out to him,
"Anata!"
and felt her hand upon his hand, and he turned and saw her kneeling beside him, smiling and beautiful as he remembered her, only a little pale. Then his heart leapt so that he could not speak for the wonder and the doubt and the joy of that moment. But she said,
"Do not doubt. It is really I am not dead. It was all a mistake. I was buried because my people thought me dead, buried too soon. And my own parents thought me dead and went upon a pilgrimage. Yet, you see, I am not dead, not a ghost. It is I. Do not doubt it. And I have seen your heart, and that was worth all the waiting and the pain. But now let us go away at once to another city, so that people may not know this thing and trouble us, for all still believe me dead."
And they went away, no one observing them. And they went even to the village of Minobu, which is in the province of Kai, for there is a famous temple of the Nichiren Shu in that place. And the girl had said,
"I know that in the course of their pilgrimage, my parents will surely visit Minobu, so that if we dwell there, they will find us, and we shall be all again together."
And when they came to Minobu, she said,
"Let us open a little shop."
And they opened a little food shop on the wide way leading to the holy place. And there they sold cakes for children, and toys, and food for pilgrims. For 2 years they so lived and prospered, and there was a son born to them. Okay, so he came back from the war. He found out she had not died, and they moved to another city, and they had a life there. Okay, they have a kid too. Now, when the child was 1 year and 2 months old, the parents of the wife came in the course of their pilgrimage to Minobu, and they stopped at the little shop to buy food. And seeing their daughter's betrothed, they cried out and wept and asked questions. Then he made them enter and bowed down before them and astonished them, saying, "Truly, as I speak it, your daughter is not dead, and she is my wife, and we have a son. And she is even now within the farther room, lying down with the child. I pray you go in at once and gladden her, for her heart longs for the moment of seeing you again." So while he busied himself in making all things ready for their comfort, they entered the inner room very softly, the mother first. They found the child asleep, but the mother they did not find. She seemed to have gone out for a little while only. Her pillow was still warm. They waited long for her. Then they began to seek her, but never was she seen again. And they understood only when they found beneath the coverings which had covered the mother and child something which they remembered having left years before in the temple of Myokochi, a little mortuary tablet, the ihai of their buried daughter. The end. That's it. So I think what that means is that she was a ghost. But it's weird though. Like, they had a kid, right? What about the kid? Is the kid a ghost or is it a real kid? The story does not say. The story does not say. I'm hoping it's a real kid. We need the sequel. All right. To mate for you. Good night. Was that a happy ending? That was kind of a happy ending. He had a kid, but she was still dead. She dead. Johanna says, you can make out with the ghost? Yeah, of course you can. Like, you never done that before? I'll ask the ghost in the other room. We'll do that for the stream. This house is so dark, you guys. So there's bound to be a freaking ghost around here somewhere. Did he do it to a tablet? Right? Is the kid a tablet too? There's a lot of questions here. I don't think she stole the kid. I think they just did it. They just did the deed and they had the kid. But now she's gone though. Linfamy is dating a ghost. There are worse things to date. Okay. So do you guys? Okay. Oh yeah, I'm gonna ask again. So do you guys want this screen or this screen while I read? So we saw the two ways that I did it. Let me know which one allows you to follow the story better. Or just which one you like better. Dun, 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 dun. Kate asks, is the tablet made of candy? I deserve some snacks. I have tea. I have my little teacup. It looks pretty cool. Oh, you guys want to see my teapot? Yeah, it's a cute little teapot. Text, face, text. Your face adds a lot of scariness. All right, let's do face. I'm still just gonna switch off. So the next one, this next story, I'll do the face, and the one after that, I'll do the text. All right, next story. This one, the chapter is called Ingwa Banashi. And apparently that means, I think, that means tales of fate. I think the English spelling is different. All right, whatever. All right, you ready? The daimyo's wife was dying, and knew that she was dying. She had not been able to leave her bed since the early autumn of the 10th Bunsei. It was now the fourth month of the 12th Bunsei, the year 1829 by Western counting, and the cherry trees were blossoming. She thought of the cherry trees in her garden and of the gladness of spring. I burped. She thought of her children. She thought of her husband's various concubines, especially the Lady Yukiko, 19 years old. My dear wife, said the daimyo, you have suffered very much for 3 long years. We have done all that we could to get you well, watching beside you day and night, praying for you and often fasting for your sake. But in spite of our loving care and in spite of the skill of our best physicians, it would now seem that the end of your life is not far off. Probably we shall sorrow more than you will sorrow, because of your having to leave what the Buddha so truly termed this burning house of the world. I shall order to be performed, no matter what the cost, every religious rite that can serve you in regard to your next rebirth, and all of us will pray without ceasing for you, that you may not have to wander in the black space, but may quickly enter paradise and attain Buddhahood. He spoke with the utmost tenderness, caressing her the while. Then, with eyelids closed, she answered him in a voice thin as the voice of an insect.
I am grateful, most grateful, for your kind words. Yes, it is true, as you say, that I have been sick for 3 long years, and that I have been treated with all possible care and affection. Why, indeed, should I turn away from the one true path at the very moment of my death?
Perhaps to think of worldly matters at such a time is not right, but I have one last request to make.
Only one. Call here to me the Lady Yukiko. You know that I love her like a sister. I want to speak to her about the affairs of this household.
Yukiko came at the summons of the Lord, and in obedience to a sign from him, knelt down beside the couch. The daimyo's wife opened her eyes and looked at Yukiko and spoke.
Ah, here is Yukiko. I am so pleased to see you, Yukiko. Come a little closer so that you can hear me well. I am not able to speak loud. Yukiko, I am going to die. I hope that you will be faithful in all things to our dear Lord, for I want you to take my place when I am gone. I hope that you will always be loved by him, yes, even 100 times more than I have been, and that you will very soon be promoted to a higher rank and become his honored wife. And I beg of you always to cherish our dear Lord, never allow another woman to rob you of his affection. This is what I wanted to say to you, dear Yukiko. Have you been able to understand? Oh, my dear lady,
protested Yukiko. I can't do 2 ladies' voices.
Do not, I entreat you, to say such strange things to me. You well know that I am of poor or mean condition. How could I ever dare to aspire to become the wife of our Lord?
Nay, nay, returned the wife huskily.
This is not a time for words of ceremony. Let us speak only the truth to each other. After my death, you will certainly be promoted to a higher place. And now I assure you again that I wish you to become the wife of our Lord. Yes, I wish this, Yukiko, even more than I wish to become a Buddha. Ah, I had almost forgotten. I want you to do something for me, Yukiko. You know that in the garden there is a yae sakura.
Let's see what that is. There is a cherry tree, a type of cherry tree.
There is a cherry tree which was brought here the year before last from Mount Yoshino in Yamato. I have been told that it is now in full bloom, and I wanted to so much to see it flower. In a little while I shall be dead. I must see that tree before I die. Now I wish you to carry me into the garden at once, Yukiko, so that I can see it. Yes. Upon your back, Yukiko. Take me upon your back.
So the dying wife is gonna go on Yukiko's back to go see the tree. While thus asking, her voice had gradually become clear and strong, as if the intensity of the wish had given her new force. Then she suddenly burst into tears. Yukiko knelt motionless, not knowing what to do. But the Lord nodded assent.
It is her last wish in this world, he said. She always loved cherry flowers, and I know that she wanted very much to see that Yamato tree in blossom. Come, my dear Yukiko, let her have her will.
As a nurse turns her back to a child, that the child may cling to it, Yukiko offered her shoulders to the wife and said,
Lady, I am ready. Please, tell me how best I can help you.
Why, this way, responded the dying woman, lifting herself with an almost superhuman effort by clinging to Yukiko's shoulders. But as she stood erect, she quickly slipped her thin hands down over the shoulders, under the robe, and clutched the breasts of the girl, and burst into a wicked laugh.
I have my wish, she cried. I have my wish for the cherry bloom, but not for the cherry bloom of the garden.
That's the cherry bloom that she was talking about.
I could not die before I got my wish. Now I have it. Oh, what a delight.
And with these words, she fell forward upon the crashing girl and died. Did not expect that. The attendants at once attempted to lift the body from Yukiko's shoulders and to lay it upon the bed. But strange to say, this seemingly easy thing could not be done. The cold hands had attached themselves in some unaccountable way to the breasts of this girl, appeared to have grown into the quick flesh. Yukiko became senseless with fear and pain. So the dying woman's hand is stuck to the girl's breast and appeared to have grown into the flesh of the girl's breast. Come on, you guys did not expect that to happen, did you? Physicians were called. They could not understand what had taken place. By no ordinary methods could the hands of the dead woman be unfastened from the body of her victim. They so clung that any effort to remove them brought blood. This was not because the fingers held. It was because the flesh of the palms had united itself in some inexplicable manner to the flesh of the breasts. At that time, the most skillful physician in Yedo was a foreigner, a Dutch surgeon. It was decided to summon him. After a careful examination, he said that he could not understand the case, and that for the immediate relief of Yukiko, there was nothing to be done except to cut the hands from the corpse. He declared that it would be dangerous to attempt to detach them from the breasts. His advice was accepted, and the hands were amputated at the wrists, but they remained clinging to the breasts, and they soon darkened and dried up, like the hands of a person long dead. Yet this was only the beginning of the horror. Withered and bloodless, though they seemed, those hands were not dead. At intervals, they would stir, stealthily, like great gray spiders, and nightly thereafter, beginning always at the hour of the ox. They would clutch and compress and torture. Only at the hour of the tiger, the pain would cease. Yukiko cut off her hair and became a mendicant nun, taking the religious name of Dasetsu. She had an ihai made, bearing the kaimyo of her dead mistress. Kaimyo is... what is it? Oops. Not telling me. I think like just words on the tablet. And this she carried about with her in all her wanderings. And every day before it, she humbly besought the dead for pardon and performed a Buddhist service in order that the jealous spirit might find rest. But the evil karma that had rendered such an affliction possible could not soon be exhausted. Every night at the hour of the ox, the hands never failed to torture her during more than 17 years, according to the testimony of those persons to whom she last told her story. When she stopped for one evening at the house of Noguchi Dengo Zaiyemon in the village of Tanaka in the district of Kawachi in the province of Shimotsuke. This was in the third year of Kokwa. Thereafter, nothing more was ever heard of her. The end. That was unexpected. That lady really liked cherry blossoms, it seems. That was a ghost breast attack. Law says that's a weird hentai story. Ghost hands that squeeze bobs. Yeah, I should make a video out of that. You guys would like that. Griff says some of the yokai are so weird, like Kappa. And this. Yeah, Yukiko did nothing wrong. What the hell? She just wanted to carry her lady to the freaking garden. And this is what happens? That's the ending. Yeah, that's it. That's the whole story. So she has to suffer forever for the rest of her life, I think. Dun. All right. Let's do another story. Pain or pleasure? Pretty much pain. Yeah. The hands, that woman's hand dried up. So it's like it's stuck to her boobs. It's just dried up. A dried up thing. Not cool. All right. Story number 4. The Reconciliation. You ready? There was a young samurai of Kyoto who had been reduced to poverty by the ruin of his lord and found himself obliged to leave his home and to take service with the governor of a distant province. Before quitting the capital, this samurai divorced his wife, a good and beautiful woman, under the belief that he could better obtain promotion by another alliance. He then married the daughter of a family of some distinction and took her with him to the district whither he had been called. So this samurai divorced his wife to go to a distant province and married another wife. But it was in the time of the thoughtlessness of youth and the sharp experience of want, that the samurai could not understand the worth of the affection so lightly cast away. His second marriage did not prove a happy one. The character of his new wife was hard and selfish, and he soon found every cause to think with regret of Kyoto days. Then he discovered that he still loved his first wife, loved her more than he could ever love the second, and he began to feel how unjust and how thankless he had been. Gradually, his repentance deepened into a remorse that left him no peace of mind. Memories of the woman he had wronged, her gentle speech, her smiles, her dainty, pretty ways, her faultless patience, continually haunted him. Sometimes in dreams, he saw her at her loom, weaving, as when she toiled night and day to help him during the years of their distress. More often, he saw her kneeling alone in the desolate little room where he had left her, veiling her tears with her poor, worn sleeve. Aww. Even in the hours of official duty, his thoughts would wander back to her. Then he would ask himself how she was living, what she was doing. Something in his heart assured him that she could not accept another husband, and that she never would refuse to pardon him. And he secretly resolved to seek her out as soon as he could return to Kyoto, then to beg her forgiveness, to take her back, to do everything a man could do to make atonement. But the years went by. Oh, he wants to get back with her, guys. I'm sure this will end in a happy ending. Alas, the governor's official term expired, and the samurai was free. Now I will go back to my dear one, he vowed to himself. Ah, what a cruelty. What a folly to have divorced her. He sent his second wife to her own people. She had given him no children. And hurrying to Kyoto, he went at once. He just gave back the second wife. This guy. This samurai. He sent his second wife to her own people. She had given him no children. And hurrying to Kyoto, he went at once to seek his former companion, not allowing himself even the time to change his traveling garb. When he reached the street where she used to live, it was late in the night, the night of the 10th day of the 9th month, and the city was silent as a cemetery. But a bright moon made everything visible, and he found the house without difficulty. It had a deserted look. Tall weeds were growing on the roof. He knocked at the sliding doors, and no one answered. Then, finding that the doors had not been fastened from within, he pushed them open and entered. The front room was matless and empty. A chilly wind was blowing through crevices in the planking, and the moon shone through a ragged brick in the wall of the alcove. Other rooms presented like a forlorn condition. The house, to all seeming, was unoccupied. Nevertheless, the samurai determined to visit one other apartment at the farther end of the dwelling, a very small room that had been his wife's favorite resting place. Approaching the sliding screen that closed it, he was startled to perceive a glow within. He pushed the screen aside and uttered a cry of joy, for he saw her there, sewing by the light of a paper lamp. Her eyes at the same instant met his own, and with a happy smile she greeted him, asking only, "When did you come back to Kyoto? How did you find your way here to me, though through all those black rooms?" The years had not changed her. Still, she seemed as fair and young as in his fondest memory of her, but sweeter than any memory. There came to him the music of her voice, with its trembling of pleased wonder. I don't think I did her the music of her voice justice. Then, joyfully, he took his place beside her and told her all. How deeply he repented his selfishness, how wretched he had been without her, how constantly he had regretted her, how long he had hoped and planned to make amends, caressing her all the while and asking her forgiveness over and over again. She answered him with loving gentleness, according to his heart's desire, entreating him to cease all self-reproach. It was wrong, she said, that he should have allowed himself to suffer on her account. She had always felt that she was not worthy to be his wife. She knew that he had separated from her, notwithstanding, only because of poverty. And while he lived with her, he had always been kind, and she had never ceased to pray for his happiness. But even if there had been a reason for speaking of amends, this honorable visit would be ample amends. For greater happiness than thus to see him again, though it were only for a moment.
"Only for a moment?" he replied with a glad laugh. "Say, rather, for the time of 7 existences, my loved one. Unless you forbid, I am coming back to live with you, always, always. Nothing shall ever separate us again. Now I have means and friends. We need not fear poverty. Tomorrow my goods will be brought here, and my servants will come to wait upon you, and we shall make this house beautiful. Tonight," he added apologetically, "I came thus late, without even changing my dress, only because of the longing I had to see you and to tell you this."
She seemed greatly pleased by these words, and in her turn she told him about all that had happened in Kyoto since the time of his departure, excepting her own sorrows, of which she sweetly refused to speak. They chatted far into the night. Then she conducted him to a warmer room facing south, a room that had been their bridal chamber in former time.
"Have you no one in the house to help you?" he asked, as she began to prepare the couch for him.
"No," she answered, laughing cheerfully. "I could not afford a servant, so I have been living all alone."
"You will have plenty of servants tomorrow," he said. "Good servants, and everything else that you need."
They lay down to rest. Not to sleep, they had too much to tell each other, and they talked of the past, and the present, and the future, until the dawn was gray. Then, involuntarily, the samurai closed his eyes and slept. When he awoke, the daylight was streaming through the chinks of the sliding shutters, and he found himself, to his utter amazement, lying upon the naked boards of a moldering floor. Had he only dreamed a dream? No, she was there. She slept. He bent above her and looked, and shrieked, for the sleeper had no face. Before him, wrapped in its grave sheet only, lay the corpse of a woman, a corpse so wasted that little remained save the bones and the long black tangled hair. Slowly, as he stood shuddering and sickening in the sun, the icy horror yielded to a despair so intolerable, a pain so atrocious, that he clutched at the mocking shadow of a doubt. Feigning ignorance of the neighborhood, he ventured to ask his way to the house in which his wife had lived.
"There is no one in that house," said the person questioned. "It used to belong to the wife of a samurai who left the city several years ago.
He divorced her in order to marry another woman before he went away, and she fretted a great deal and so became sick. She had no relatives in Kyoto and nobody to care for her, and she died in the autumn of the same year on the 10th day of the 9th month.
That's it. The end. Ah, the old sleeping with a dead woman story. That's nasty. There seems to be a lot of these kinds of stories in Japanese folklore.
Chad's like, she's dead, boy. She's dead, boys.
Milani says, I thought the vacuum right next to me was a person, so I got really scared. I'm sorry that happened to you. Hey, if you guys get the chance, hey, if you guys are listening to this, maybe turn off the lights, lower the lights, get in the mood. I think it was just a ghost. He did sleep with a dead body. Yeah, so the moral of the story is, hey, don't be a dick, right? He left the first wife just for a promotion and for his career. I like how he just left his second wife, like he doesn't care, like forget about it. Drift says all the lights are off. Good job, Drift. Yeah, happy Halloween, guys. Like, what are you guys doing for Halloween? Do people do trick-or-treat? Do people go, like, trick-or-treating this year? I know some people who told me they were going to go trick-or-treating, but I can't imagine that there's going to be a lot of people doing that. What's up, Riley?
Hi.
You do not do Halloween. Okay. All right, I think we got two more stories. People are just going to leave the candy out for the kids. No, you can't do that. You can't trust these kids. You know they're just going to grab like a bunch of candy. Some asshole kid is just going to grab all the candy. Oh, you're eating candy just at home? That's a good way to do it. All right, next story. Nikki says, these have all been good so far. Awesome. All right. Next story. This one is called Of a Promise Kept. I shall return in the early autumn, said Akana Soyemon several hundred years ago when bidding goodbye to his brother by adoption, young Hasebe Samon. The time was spring, and the place was the village of Kato in the province of Harima. Akana was an Izumo samurai, and he wanted to visit his birthplace. Hasebe said, Your Izumo... Wait, okay. What kind of voice should we give him?
Your Izumo, the country of the eight cloud rising, is very distant. Perhaps it will...
That sounds like a girl or an old lady.
Perhaps it will be It will therefore be difficult for you to promise to return here upon any particular day, but if we were to know the exact day, we should feel happier. We could then prepare a feast of welcome, and we could watch at the gateway for your coming.
Why, as for that, responded Akana, I have been so much accustomed to travel that I can usually tell beforehand how long it will take me to reach a place, and I can safely promise you to be here upon a particular day. Suppose we say the day of the festival, Choyo?
That is the 9th day of the 9th month, said Hasebe. Then the chrysanthemums will be in bloom, and we can go together to look at them. How pleasant! So you promise to come back on the 9th day of the 9th month?
On the 9th day of the 9th month, repeated Akana, smiling farewell. Then he strode away from the village of Kato in the province of Harima, and Hasebe-samon and the mother of Hasebe looked after him with tears in their eyes. So Akana is going off to Izumo province, but he promises to come back at a certain date. Neither the sun nor the moon, says an old Japanese proverb, ever halt upon their journey. Swiftly, the months went by and the autumn came, the season of chrysanthemums. And early upon the morning of the 9th day of the 9th month, Hasebe prepared to welcome his adopted brother. He made ready a feast of good things, bought wine, decorated the guest room, and filled the vases of the alcove with chrysanthemums of two colors. Then his mother, watching him, said,
The province of Izumo, my son, is more than 100 ri from this place, and the journey thence over the mountains is difficult and weary, and you cannot be sure that Akana will be able to come today. Would it not be better, before you take all this trouble, to wait for his coming?
Nay, mother, Hasebe made answer, Akana promised to be here today. He could not break a promise, and if he were to see us beginning to make preparation after his arrival, he would know that we had doubted his word, and we should be put to shame. The day was beautiful, the sky without a cloud, and the air so pure that the world seemed to be 1,000 miles wider than usual. In the morning, many travelers passed through the village, some of them samurai, and Hasebe, watching each as he came, more than once imagined that he saw Akana approaching. But the temple bells sounded the hour of midday, and Akana did not appear. Through the afternoon also, Hasebe watched and waited in vain. The sun set, and still there was no sign of Akana. Nevertheless, Hasebe remained at the gate, gazing down the road. Later, his mother went to him and said,
The mind of a man, my son, as our proverb declares, may change as quickly as the sky of autumn, but your chrysanthemum flowers will still be fresh tomorrow. Better now to sleep, and in the morning you can watch again for Akana, if you wish.
Rest well, mother, returned Hasebe, but I still believe that he will come. Then the mother went to her own room, and Hasebe lingered at the gate. The night was pure as the day had been, and the sky throbbed with stars, and the white river of heaven shimmered with unusual splendor. The village slept, the silence was broken only by the noise of a little brook, and by the faraway barking of peasants' dogs. Hasebe still waited until he saw the thin moon sink behind the neighboring hills. Then at last he began to doubt and to fear. Just as he was about to re-enter the house, he perceived in the distance a tall man approaching very lightly and quickly, and in the next moment he recognized Akana.
Oh, he cried. Oh, cried Hasebe, springing to meet him. I have been waiting for you from the morning until now. So you really did keep your promise, after all. But you must be tired, poor brother. Come in, everything is ready for you.
He guided Akana to the place of honor in the guest room, and hastened to trim the lights, which were burning low.
Mother, continued Hasebe, felt a little tired this evening, and she has already gone to bed, but I shall awaken her presently.
Akana shook his head and made a little gesture of disapproval. As you will, brother, said Hasebe, and he set warm food and wine before the traveler. Akana did not touch the food or the wine.
but remained motionless and silent for a short time. Then, speaking in a whisper, as if fearful of awakening the mother, he said,
"Now I must tell you how it happened that I came thus late. When I returned to Izumo, I found that the people had almost forgotten the kindness of our former ruler, the good Lord Enya, and were seeking the favor of usurper Tsunehisa, who had possessed himself of the Tonda Castle. But I had to visit my cousin, Akana Tanji, though he had accepted service under Tsunehisa and was living as a retainer within the castle grounds. He persuaded me to present myself before Tsunehisa. I yielded chiefly in order to observe the character of the new ruler, whose face I had never seen. He is a skilled soldier and of great courage, but he is cunning and cruel. I found it necessary to let him know that I could never enter into his service. After I left his presence, he ordered my cousin to detain me, to keep me confined within the house. I protested that I had promised to return to Harima upon the 9th day of the 9th month, but I was refused permission to go. I then hoped to escape from the castle at night, but I was constantly watched, and until today I could find no way to fulfill my promise.
Until today, exclaimed Hasebe in bewilderment. The castle is more than 100 ri from here.
Yes, returned Akana, and no living man can travel on foot 100 ri in one day. But I felt that, if I did not keep my promise, you could not think well of me, and I remembered the ancient proverb, Tamayoku ichi nichis, nichi ni sen ri yo. The soul of a man can journey 1,000 ri in a day. Fortunately, I had been allowed to keep my sword, thus only was I able to come to you. Be good to our mother. With these words, he stood up, and in the same instant disappeared.
Then Hasebe knew that Akana had killed himself in order to fulfill the promise. At earliest dawn, Hasebe-saman set out for the castle Tonda, in the province of Izumo. Reaching Matsue, he there learned that on the night of the 9th day of the 9th month, Akana Soyemon had performed harakiri in the house of Akana Tanji in the grounds of the castle. Then Hasebe went on to the house of Akana Tanji and reproached Akana Tanji for the treachery done, and slew him in the midst of his family and escaped without hurt. And when the Lord Tsunehisa had heard the story, he gave commands that Hasebe should not be pursued, for although an unscrupulous and cruel man himself, the Lord Tsunehisa could respect the love of truth in others and could admire the friendship and the courage of Hasebe Samon.
That's it.
The end.
How was that? So the guy killed himself just to keep his promise that he would return home.
Yeah.
You know, if I was his brother, like, if I were his brother, I wouldn't, like, I would have said, like, you didn't really need to do that, bro. That's one promise that you don't have to keep. Like, dun, 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 dun. All right, guys, one more story, our last story. The last story of our impromptu stream. All right. The legend of Yurei Daki.
What? Switch it to the face? All right. switching to the face for the last story. Good idea. Hopefully you guys can follow. All right, the legend of Yureidaki. Near the village of Kurosaka in the province of Hoki, there is a waterfall called Yureidaki, or the Cascade of Ghosts. Why is it so called? I do not know. Near the foot of the fall, there is a small Shinto shrine of the god of the locality, whom the people name Taki Daimyojin. And in front of the shrine is a little wooden money box to receive the offerings of believers. And there is a story about that money box. One icy winter's evening, 35 years ago, the women and girls employed at a certain Asatoriba or hemp factory in Kurosaka gathered around the big brazier in the spinning room after their day's work had been done. Then they amused themselves by telling ghost stories. By the time that a dozen stories had been told, most of the gathering felt uncomfortable, and a girl cried out just to heighten the pleasure of fear. Only think of going this night all by oneself to the Yureidaki. The suggestion provoked a general scream, followed by nervous bursts of laughter.
I'll give all the hemp I spun today, mockingly said one of the party, to the person who goes.
So will I, exclaimed another.
And I, said a third.
All of us, affirmed a fourth.
And then from among the spinners stood up one Yasumo Okatsu, the wife of a carpenter. She had her only son, a boy of 2 years old, snugly wrapped up and asleep upon her back.
Listen, said Okatsu, if you will all really agree to make over to me all the hemp spun today, I will go to the Yureidaki.
Her proposal was received with cries of astonishment and of defiance, but after having been several times repeated, it was seriously taken. Each of the spinners, in turn, agreed to give up her share of the day's work to Okatsu, providing that Okatsu should go to the Yureidaki.
Oh, the Yureidaki is that waterfall. The waterfall, the cascade of ghosts.
But how are we to know if she really goes there? A sharp voice asked.
Why, let her bring back the money box of the god, answered an old woman whom the spinners called Oba-san, the grandmother.
That will be proof enough.
I'll bring it, cried Okatsu, and out she darted into the street with her sleeping boy upon her back.
The night was frosty, but clear. Down the empty street, Okatsu hurried, and she saw that all the house fronts were tightly closed because of the piercing cold. Out of the village and along the high road she ran, with the great silence of frozen rice fields on either hand, and only the stars to light her. After an hour, she followed the open road. Then she turned down a narrower way, winding under cliffs. Darker and rougher the path became, and she, as she proceeded, but she knew it well, and she soon heard the dull roar of the water. A few minutes more, and the way widened into a glen, and the dull roar suddenly became a loud clamor. And before her she saw, looming against a mass of blackness, the long glimmering of the fall. Dimly she perceived the shrine, the money box. She rushed forward, put out her hand.
Oi, Okatsu-san!
Suddenly called a warning voice above the crash of the water. Okatsu stood motionless, stupefied by terror.
Oi, Okatsu-san!
Again pealed the voice, this time with more of menace in its tone. But Okatsu was a really bold woman. At once, recovering from her stupefaction, she snatched up the money box and ran. She neither heard nor saw anything more to alarm her until she reached the high road, where she stopped a moment to take a breath. Then she ran on steadily until she got to Kurosaka and thumped at the door of the Asatoriba. So she got back to where the other women are.
Now, how the woman and the girls cried out as she entered, panting, with the money box of the god in her hand. Breathlessly, they heard her story. Sympathetically, they screeched when she told them of the voice that had called her name twice out of the haunted water. What a woman! Brave Okatsu! Well, she had earned the hemp.
But your boy must be cold, Okatsu, cried the Oba-san. Let us have him here by the fire. He ought to be hungry, exclaimed the mother. I must give him his milk presently. Poor Okatsu, said the Oba-san, helping to remove the wraps in which the boy had been carried. Why, you are all wet behind. Then with a husky scream, the helper vociferated, Ara! It is blood! And out of the wrappings unfastened there fell to the floor a blood-soaked bundle of baby clothes that left exposed two very small brown feet and two very small brown hands. Nothing more. The child's head had been torn off. The end. I think, wait, yes, the end. Yeah. Did you guys like that? Wait, no, the kid didn't fall. What? The kid is no longer a kid. It only had 2 feet and 2 hands. Nothing more. Freaking ghost. Why did they have to hurt the kid? Well, I think that's it. Oh, Gyro, you saw that coming? Good job. What killed the baby? I think it was whatever that voice was, right? That was like yelling by the waterfall. Kakume said, what? So the god ate the kid's head? Did I miss something? No, you didn't miss it. Like, she didn't see anything. So she just got, she went to the waterfall, she got the money box, and came back. She heard the voice, and then, but she ignored it and came back. But apparently, he did something to the boy. Now his head is gone. Right? Why didn't she leave the kid home? Good question. Dun, dun, dun. All right, I think that's it. That's all I have for you guys. We've been going on for an hour and 13 minutes. So that's pretty good. All right, well, guys, this was just an impromptu thing. Like I said, I was reading some ghost stories, and I figured I figured it would be a good idea to just read it for you guys. Make it a whole thing. So this was fun for me. I hope it was fun for you. Do I believe in ghosts? And have I ever seen one? I do not believe in ghosts. And I have not seen one. You freaking knew the kid would die. All right, guys. Happy Halloween. Hope you enjoy your Halloween tomorrow or today for some of you. All right, bye, guys. Thanks for joining, and I love you, and I'll see you in the next video. Come on, stream. End.